West Indies cricket, Caribbean cricket podcast. West Indies cricket, Caribbean cricket podcast.
Yes, 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 ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to another edition of the Caribbean Cricket Podcast. It's been a minute. It's been a minute, actually. I haven't checked in with you lot in a while. You know, I've been living my life and going to work and stuff like that. Listen, I'm on half of the Caribbean Cricket Podcast, Machel St. Patrick Hewitt, and this episode is all about the West Indies women's team. The T20 World Cup is upon us. The first game for the West Indies women. Let me just look at my diary. The first game for the West Indies women is on Friday coming against South Africa. That's probably the pivotal game of the group for us. Then Sunday the 6th, we play Scotland. Thursday the 10th, this is all October, obviously, we play Bangladesh. And then we end the group with a game against England on the 15th of October. The top two go through to the next stage. We're not even going to look at, or I'm not even going to talk about next stage or any possibilities yet. We're just going to talk about the kind of prep for the World Cup and so on and so forth. Earlier this week, I dropped a short. So last week on the call-in show, which is every Monday, if you're new to the Caribbean Cricket Podcast, every Monday, usually about 10:15, 10:30 UK time, we do a live call-in show. If you want to be part of that, call in. Call in. Call in via the YouTube medium. We give you the link, etc., and have your say. But last week, I made a point where I said Hayley Matthews walks into my West Indies men's team, and ever since then, I've had a whole bunch of uncles, young and old, saying you don't know what you're talking about. You're a fool. This, that, this, that. Some of you are misogynists. Let's be real. Some of you are misogynists. Let's not try and... Your point may still be valid, but what you saw was the rage descended on you that somebody would dare suggest that a woman could compete with men. And that inner misogyny in you just came out raging. But that's your problem. That's not my problem. I'm here for the liberation of women. So you need to explain yourself. I don't need to explain myself. But I still stand by that point. But I will, before I go into the West Indies women's team and our chances in the World Cup, I will just give people a caveat on that point, which, based on the kind of reaction and people saying I'm ridiculous for this, that, and the third, I thought, let me just give a bit of a caveat and an explanation. One of the reasons why I made the point wasn't just because I think Hayley is better than the average West Indian male is willing to give her credit for. And most of the responses I got was, oh, she'll be killed. She'll be killed. And I thought, stop for a minute and just think about what you're saying. You're basing that argument on the fact that she's a woman and nothing else. Because you have no evidence to suggest that. You're just saying she'll be killed. Every time somebody said that to me, I was like, what's your evidence for that? And it goes back to that internalized misogyny that you hold. Again, that's something you have to address. I can't address that for you. You need to look inwards within your soul and wonder why that came to the fore. You probably think that women should still be cooking your dinner. Anyways, that's another argument for another day. It's a Caribbean Cricket Podcast. You lot ain't ready for this episode. But anyways, the point I was actually making is that it was more a reflection on the standards and where we are at. My whole thing is anybody and everybody gets a West Indies call up these days. You don't even have to have been consistently good to have got a West Indies call up. These days, you just have to have scored some runs at any point in time, and you're probably going to make the West Indies team, whether you deserve to be there or not. And my point is simple. If that is the criteria for West Indies selection now, and you don't even have to show seasons of consistency, then Hayley might as well get a pick. Anybody might as well get a pick. At this point, that's actually the reason I was making the point. But like I say, people's misogyny came out before they actually engaged their brain with the point. The second point I would make is this. A lot of people are messaging me saying, such and such bowlers would bowl down Hayley quick time. And I was thinking, but the same bowlers you're talking about already bowl down our batters quick time. There's no use telling me Vasami Permol or name any other regional man that that you can think of would bowl down Hayley, they already bowl down who are supposed to be the best players in our region. So what are we really saying here? What are we? There's no standard or metric that you can give me which suggests that Hayley would be any worse than the current set of players that we're talking about. But Sammy Permol has about 10 million wickets against all of the regional men. So don't tell me he would bowl down Hayley Matthews, because he's already bowling down everyone. I might as well get called up to the West Indies team. That's really what I'm getting at here. Hayley's the best West Indies women's cricketer. And I'm just saying that as things stand right now, she is just as good a shot at making the West Indies men's team as any other average regional man, because the standards don't exist. That's ultimately the point I'm making. But big up Hayley Matthews, said same way. Anyways, let's get into it. West Indies Women's World Cup. Listen, I've got five key points I want to address here. And I should have really got this ready before the episode started. I didn't even mean to start with the Hayley Matthews point, but, you know, it is what it is. I had to just, you know, get into it. Anyways, let's call the team first things first. So here is the team as selected for the World Cup. Hayley Matthews, Aaliyah Alain, Shamila Cannell, Deandra Dottin, Shemaine Campbell, Ashmini Munassar, Afi Fletcher, Stefani Taylor, Chanel Henry, Chadeen Nation, Kishana Joseph, Zaida James, Krishma Ramarak, Mandy Mangru, and Natasha Crafton. I'm not here to kind of scrutinize every single pick in the squad. The squad is the squad, and there's people who are better versed than me who know the women's game inside out, who I would encourage you to go and listen to really scrutinize the squad that has been picked. Certainly Stacey Ann King, if she's doing any interviews, I might reach out to Stacey and say, can she come on and just do a little bits and pieces around it? But anybody can look at that squad and make some kind of generalized points. So I'm not really going to do that. I'm not going to like break the squad down and pretend that I know about the West Indies women's team better than anybody else in the region. I probably know more than a lot of people, but I'm not going to try and give you some player-by-player breakdown here. What I am going to do is just simply address the five key talking points that everyone should be mindful of going into this World Cup. And as usual, Caribbean Cricket Podcast, like, share, subscribe, get us in the comments below, whether you're angry, sad, think I'm a fool, this, that, and the third. Get us in the comments below and share it in the WhatsApps, the OnlyFans, the Snapchats, the Instas, all of that, Twitter, all of that. So point number one, the prep. Big up Osprey, who's in the Caribbean Cricket Podcast Discord group. He keeps making this point to me that he thinks the West Indies women are undercooked for the tournament. I'm not saying I agree with him, but I do think there is a question to be asked about, have they prepped accordingly for this tournament? I think Osprey, I'm sure he'll get in the comments. Look out for him in the comments. I'm sure he'll explain his point in full. Very, very knowledgeable man when it comes to kind of cricket. Well, just cricket as a whole, but certainly studying West Indies cricket, associate cricket, etc. Scotland cricket fan. And his point, and sorry, Osprey, if I'm not giving the full point in its context, is that he just doesn't think we've had enough game time ahead of this World Cup and thinks that West Indies women will struggle to make it out of the group. Could be right, could be wrong, but I hear him all the same. Our last big engagement in terms of cricket was a three-match, in terms of T20s, was a three-match tour in Sri Lanka, where we beat Sri Lanka 2-1 in June. We then, before that, sorry, in April, we went to Pakistan and beat them 4-1 in a five-match T20 series. And then the last time we had T20 engagements, I think, was in Australia in October last year. So it's three series in essentially a year in terms of T20. Obviously, earlier last month, we had the women's CPL. And that's really all you can go on, give or take those performances against Sri Lanka, to say, are these ladies ready for the World Cup? Obviously, they would have been a camp. They've had their camp in Antigua, currently in UAE. They had a bit of a kind of hit and giggle against Scotland, I think, last week. As I'm actually recording, they're about to play a warm-up game against India. And then I think Tuesday next week, they've got a warm-up game against Australia. So you would expect that we'll take some licks against India, we'll take some licks against Australia as warm-ups. But I'm not too bothered by that. You like, I wouldn't be expecting the women to go and laying down India and Australia in a warm-up game, but certainly I'm expecting them to look at those games as trying to just work out the configuration of their side, roles, responsibilities ahead of that crucial first game against South Africa on the Friday. So question marks to be asked about the prep. Obviously, like I say, get in the comments below if you've got some views as to whether we are ready or not ready for the World Cup and what your justifications are or aren't for making that particular statement. Second issue is the team 11. Now, if I go back, this is the squad. Some of you will say the 11 writes itself, but more than whether the 11 writes itself for me, and I actually think there's a debate about what the 11 might be. So what I'd love to see is people put in the comments, and I don't mean people who don't watch women's cricket. If you actually watch our women's team and know more than just Hayley Matthews in terms of women's cricket, who are the four that miss out from the final 11? I'm expecting, just looking at this squad, that initially it's going to be... See, I couldn't even tell you. I'm expecting Munisar to miss out, Natasha Crafton, Mandy Mangru. So I'd expect those three to miss out. But who's the fourth person that misses out, assuming that Stefani Taylor is fit? Who is the fourth person that misses out from that side? I suspect it would be Chadeen Nation, right? I know they might see her as like a six hitter of some kind of sort, or a power hitter of some kind of sort. I'm not sure I go along with that description, but I'm sure that's how she's supposed to be perceived. Is she the one that misses out? Because I see no argument for any of the following players not playing. Matthews, Elaine, Cannell, Doty, Campbell, Fletcher, Taylor, if she's fit, Henry, Joseph, Zaida, James, Ramarak. To me, I can't give you an argument for why any of them will miss out. So then by default for me, it has to be Chadeen Nation that misses out. So there's an argument about who are the four that miss out. And then taking it further, there's an argument about how do you construct the side. A couple of months back, or maybe 2.5 months ago, I did a video on the return of Deandra Dottin out of retirement to come back and play for the West Indies women. How do we line the side up? It's the same point I made 2 months ago, 2.5 months ago. Do we put our top three batters, if Stefani Taylor is fit, do they come in the top three? How do you structure the team around Hayley, Deandra and Stefani Taylor if we are of the assumption that those are still our three best players, with Shemaine Campbell having shown a lot more consistency over the last year, also in that mix somewhere? So let's throw Shemaine Campbell in there and see her as almost like a glue player. Not somebody that I would ever expect to be batting at over 90 strike rate on a regular basis, but somebody who might at least be there and stick at the wicket, allowing other hitters around her, whether that be Matthews, Dottin or Taylor, to be able to play their natural game around her. How do you construct the order? I'd love to know what people think, or what people think the top six should be and in what positions. The third talking point for me is, sorry, I should have written these in beforehand, but I'm putting them now. I've called it pace versus spin. I am not concerned about our spin. Obviously, Hayley can bowl, Kishana Joseph can bowl, Ramarat can bowl, Afi Fletcher can bowl. So let's say those four are all in the team. That's already, if you wanted, 16 overs of spin. This is before we even talk about Stefani Taylor, if she's fit and can bowl, and Zaida James, if they want to throw the ball to her. So spin-wise, I'm not bothered. I think we've got more than enough on those UAE wickets, assuming it is going to take a level of spin. Spin is the more dominant form of bowling in the women's game. So assuming that is the case, I look at Hayley, Afi, Karishma and Kishana and say, yeah, we got bits. We got bits. We can do some stuff with that. We can bowl economically and so on and so forth. But just my concern is, what happens if we've got a wicket which is a bit too paced and you need some clever pace bowling? I'm looking at Shamila Cannell and I'm looking at Chanel Henry and I'm saying, are they really the ones? Now, Aaliyah Lane showed up in CPL, in fairness to her. 9 wickets in CPL for Barbados Royals, economy of six. Is it a case that we look at someone like Elaine, who's shown some good form in the last however many months? Do we look to her to step up to the plate in lieu of the fact that Cannell and Henry may, I'm not saying they're spent forces, I wouldn't go that far, but they're not as consistent for me as they should be given their level of experience. So I just worry a bit about if we encounter tracks in UAE where we need a bit more savvy and we need some pace bowlers who can make an impact, have we really got that? Do we really have that strength in depth if we need a bit of variety in our attack? I'm slightly concerned, slightly worried about that. My fourth point, I know this is quite quick, people, but loads of points there for you lot to get in the comments about and give your view. My fourth point, is it Hayley or bust? This will always be the argument about the West Indies women's team. We know what Hayley Matthews can do. We done know already that when you're talking about top players in the world game, Hayley's in the conversation. Has to be in the conversation. Forget now my point about getting in the men's team. Let's just look at Hayley in her own right within the women's game. She's in the conversation. If Hayley Matthews turns up, we will beat South Africa. And beating Scotland and beating Bangladesh is a given if Hayley Matthews turns up. It's that South Africa game that's the one that we have to look at, the first one. Can we beat South Africa? And for that matter, can we beat anybody in that group if Hayley doesn't turn up? So the question mark always remains, is it Hayley or bust? Hayley Matthews was the second highest run scorer in the recently completed women's CPL. Deandra Dottin was third. Stefani Taylor only played two games and she was 13th. People will look at that and say, boy, if Hayley don't show up, are we in problems? But then Deandra, who's lacked a lot of cricket, obviously played in the women's CPL. If we can get Deandra ticking, is it too simplistic to say, is it Hayley or bust? Should we be throwing Deandra Dottin in that conversation? If Stefani Taylor is currently injury-free, should we throw her into the conversation? So is it naive to say it's Hayley Matthews or bust? Or are we still in that kind of realm of women's cricket and development where we're expecting Hayley to basically overperform and hope the rest can carry on in her slipstream? Or do we have in Deandra and Stefani two players who can step up to the plate if Hayley doesn't perform in any given game? Hayley will always perform with the ball, so we have to remember that. But I'm talking about the bat. For us to set totals or chase totals, can we do it without a Hayley Matthews masterclass? Big question mark. Big question mark. And my final point that I just want us to address before I wrap up this episode, like I say, lots of questions for people to think about. What's our expectations? For me personally, a good tournament, and I think the maximum we can truly expect of this side is getting out the group. Just getting out the group. If we didn't get out of the group, should it be seen as a disappointment? Some people are going to get upset when I say this. For me personally, no. For me personally, no. I expect us to beat Scotland. I expect us to beat Bangladesh. But that South Africa game, forget England for a minute. That South Africa game, which is our first one, feels like an eliminator game. And we've got to be honest, South Africa are, I don't want to say they're better than us, but on current trajectory, they're in a better place than us. So whilst people can look at it and say, well, if we don't get out the group X, Y, Z, we have to be honest and realistic and say, well, hold on a minute. South Africa technically are on a better trajectory than the West Indies, and it wouldn't be a shock if they beat us. If anything, if we beat them, I think that would set the cat amongst the pigeons and people would be like, oh, sugar, West Indies are here to be taken seriously. So I think on paper, South Africa are favourites for that game. That doesn't mean we can't beat them. If Hayley does her thing and is supported by Deandra and so on and so forth, yeah, we can beat them. But I think on paper, if everybody was to, not West Indies fans, if everybody who wasn't a West Indies fan who understands the women's game was to give a prediction right now, they'd say they'd put South Africa as slight favourites. And so based on that, My expectations are I wouldn't be shocked or surprised if we don't make it out of the group. And I think if we do make it out of the group, that is a very good performance by the West Indies women's team. Anything after that is a bonus, is a huge, huge bonus. People may disagree with me, though. People may disagree with me. They may say, nah, we're supposed to be doing X, Y, Z. Cool. Let me know what that is in the comments below. What do you think are the realistic expectations for this West Indies women's team? Either way, whatever people think about it, this is what I'm here to say. We rally. We rally said same way. Just like we rally for the men's, the boys, the girls. Or anybody in the maroon, we're just rallying said same way. So like I say, lock it in. Lock in your diaries, people. South Africa, Friday the 4th of October. Scotland, Sunday the 6th of October. Bangladesh, Thursday the 10th of October. And England, Tuesday the 15th of October. We've got a warm-up game that has literally just started as I'm recording against India. That's going on right now. In fact, let me see, as just to show you that I'm not lying to you. Let me just quickly look to see what's happening at the time of recording. India women are batting. West Indies women have chosen to field. And India are six without loss after two overs. And in fact, let me just see what the West Indies women's team is for that game. So West Indies women's team that's been picked for this game. Matthew, in fact, it looks like they have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Oh, it's one of them joke man matches. You're allowed 15 players per side as long as 11 bat and 11 field. Judger. Anyways, ladies and gentlemen, rally. We rally said same way. Listen, I'll be Machel St. Patrick Hute, one half the Caribbean Cricket Podcast. You done know the done know. There's plenty of pretenders out there, but there's nothing like the Caribbean Cricket Podcast. See you all very soon.
West Indies Cricket, Caribbean Cricket Podcast.